Tapan Shen, Honorable Member of Parliament, who is also the General Secretary of CITU, who, despite his busy schedule and a very stormy session at the Parliament today, is here with us to share his very valued thoughts for the benefit of all of us in proceeding ahead with the campaign to save public sector, to save the nation. Over to Comrade Tapan Shen.
Dear comrades, at the outset I must tender my apology. I committed to come here at 2, thereafter 2:30, thereafter I took permission from Comrade Franco that by 3 I will be reaching, but I reached here at 3:30. I got stuck in a very bad, unavoidable situation inside the Parliament on another important challenges before the entire rational human society. A section of the society, a section of the polity now has took upon themselves, elevated themselves, to certify in this country who is patriots, who is national, who is anti-national, and a new game has been started. On that issue there was a debate yesterday and today spillover of that, and that continued, and such situation, I could not come out. I targeted to come out before 2:45 and to reach here at 3. I got a bit delayed, so I apologize. Secondly, I have not come here. I have seen your agenda. It's not that to enrich your understanding, I have not come here. I believe you are a part of a movement who are a very crucial part of the country's trade union movement. And the agenda with which you are working here, you are dealing here, I think there is no scope of further explanation that by dilution of public sector network in our country, the country can make ever any economic progress. On this, I think there is a consensus. And if that be so, each and every step for dilution of public sector should be looked into an effort for damaging our national interest. Nowadays, anti-national or pro-national or patriot is a word is very commonly used now in political parlance. I think the real anti-national people has to be sought among those who are prescribing this formulation that let there be end of public sector regime. It holds good for financial sector, it also holds good for other segment of the public sector in the field of coal, steel, engineering and whatnot. They play a very crucial role in country's industrialization. It is the public sector, gradual expansion of public sector, which facilitated expansion of the private investment in the economy. They have provided the necessary infrastructure. They have provided credit. They have provided skilled manpower. They have provided skilled management. Everything is the contribution of public sector to this economy. And nowadays, what we sometimes hear, well, this public sector is going very bad, its efficiency has to be developed, it is to be better managed, and we have to find management talents from the market. And from the market, searching management talent means searching management talent from the private sector. As if the managerial talents are entire the monopoly of the private sector. This country, even the modern industrial management, the very concept of modern management, industrial management, has been the contribution of our public sector experience. At every step we lived and we learned And after a decade or so, we had an ever-increasing team of effective industrial management who are running the enterprises, both in real economic sector and also in financial sector, both. Today's most successful of private sector institutions, if you see, and if you really go through their management team at the upper echelon, almost 99% were all came from public sector. 99%, be it petroleum sector, Mukesh Ambani is now the hero of the country. It's upper echelon of management, if you go, more than 90% has gone from either ONGC or IOC or HPCL or BPCL or the mechanical engineering firms. Any public sector you can pick up, any private sector, major public private sector, I'm speaking, if you can pick up. And despite that, most shamelessly our policy makers are telling that this public sector is ailing. Either it has to be closed or it has to be handed over to the private hand for a better management, for a professional management. And the manner, the media and other are operating behind this philosophy, please don't mind, I am speaking in-house, some of us also started believing like that. May not be from the organizational platform, but when you are with your family, when your son says like that, instead of making him understand the whole history of public sector and country's industrialization, when he comments something, we fail to make him understand, convince our future generation. I think this aspect is a very serious issue that need to be addressed. The time has come, because now that fight has become much more crucial. It is not merely agitation which can save the situation today. I think we must seriously consider about resistance in the days to come. And for that, at least within ourselves, the understanding, there must not be any gap, confusion, dilution, self-contradiction. And in our periphery, the society with whom I daily interact, starting from my family, I think this understanding had to be built up, that if you are to save your country, I think that's a priority for us, you have to save public sector. And the public sector unions, they are fighting for saving public sector, not for saving their job alone, for the country, to save the country as a whole. It is not that workers are fighting, so it is their own interest. I am telling you, even in the political movement also, nothing is without politics, you cannot ignore the politics also. In the political circle also, radical, progressive political circles also, the anti-privatization struggle is basically it is trade unions' business and nobody else's. You are part of the trade union movement, although you are registered under society that whatever it may, but part of the trade union movement. This inclusive, we are telling you. I think this, on this area, I think you have something to contribute. Every after one after another, comrades have told about their respective segments, their contribution. I need not go into that area at all. That you know already. Rather, from your literature, we can gather, you please feed us continuously, some sector-specific, institution-specific understanding we can develop, we can build up. So rather, you have to educate us with the institution-specific inputs about their role, about the thing. It is based on your inputs only. I am basically, I like to introduce myself as a trade unionist. My present MPship is a temporary phenomenon. My trade union life is more than 4.5 decades today. So it's a temporary phenomena, but even during this role, whenever we spoke on the RRB, the act they have amended, Banking Regulation Act they brought, at every stage they weakened the public sector, strength of public sector. At every stage they disempowered different public sector agencies, so far as the bank is concerned. Disempowering central bank is a part of disempowerment of the entire public sector banking network. This is to be understood. So we got input from you only while fighting inside the parliament against those provisions. We could not stop it because again the country's political composition, parliament's political composition is basically against all these exercises. So we are the minority in that respect. That minority position is supplemented by a continuous rallying of the workers, you included, on the street of the country against privatization. So this is the combination with which we have to strategize our struggle and fight. And now we came to a stage of a kind of resistance, comrade. You must understand very clearly. Situation has come to that stage. So I am not at all going, how bad is privatization? That you all know. I think that stage has come where you have to seriously consider. What do you do? Things are moving. It's not waiting for you. You may not be able to stop many of the legislative exercise, many of the executive exercise they will be deciding upon. But we can definitely do our bit when they will go in translating those legislation or executive order on the field. And we must be in a position to do our bit to stall that. I say that's the stage of resistance. I think gradually we are heading towards that kind of a compulsion in our movement. So with that, I think you have to think about your plan. So far as country's trade union movement is concerned, it has passed through also a lot of hurdles. When 1991 this neoliberalism came into being, the complete upside down, the whole abandoning the 1956 policy resolution, identifying, recognizing public sector as in the commanding height of the economy, facilitator of country's industrialization, expansion of financial network, nationalization of bank, insurance, played a crucial role in the space of country's industrialization and public sector's commanding role in the economy. Very crucial role in the 70s, which led to expansion of the small scale industries, led to expansion of much equitable credit, both in the Indian rural economy and also in the urban economy. But it has also got its limitation, after all, that is operating within the capitalist framework. It expanded up to a period and thereafter started shrinking its position. And you are also failing to stall that provision, stall that space. Despite our all RRBs and NABARD, etc., 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 how can you deny that more than two-thirds of the small and our farming community, all small and marginal farmers, are out of the institutional credit network of our country? You did your best, no doubt of it. But still that best could touch only the fringe of the problem. And particularly when the agrarian economy is passing into a deeper and deeper and deeper crisis, and the small and marginal farmers are the major hit, they are moving away from agriculture, and a reverse land concentration is taking place, through which the capitalist infiltration on the one hand, a bigger concentration of land along with capital on the one hand, and on the other, impoverization of complete destruction of petty production and impoverization of masses. Both together has adding further fuel to the crisis which has already engulfed the world capitalist order. And this, if you say, when you talk of inequality, various international agencies are bringing out data, startling data about inequality. The whole process of building this inequality is this, that in the traditional sector, the petty production is getting destroyed, and greater capital and asset concentration in fewer hands. This together is creating a process for a widespread transfer of resources from the millions to handful. Even 5 years earlier, five years earlier, the international estimate said that more than 125 households control the 50% of the global wealth, and now it is 62 households. No more 150. Latest Oxfam data says it is 62 households, and out of that, 3 are Indians. You have every reason to feel pride. You have 3 Indians in that. Can such obscene accumulation of wealth be done by fair means? No. Even the capital invested with reasonable returns cannot ensure such accumulation of wealth. It is an expropriation of the people, looting on the people, looting on the society, looting on the national asset. Through that, such inequality could be brought up in the society, which is every stage developing hurdle for economic growth even under capitalist regime. Because the market on which capitalism depends, if that market starts getting shrunk every day, the investment cannot expand. Goods and services cannot be produced because it needs a market, and that market is getting shrunk, not only within our country but all over the world. And there is a gain, there is a competition, and there is a pressure by the World Bank, IMF and the international agencies to transfer their crisis on the developing countries and enlist the ruling polity of those respective countries into their pocket. We are passing through that particular phase in our country's political history. Public sector, same public sector task, the importance of that task cannot be even understood, realized without an understanding of the overall operation which is going on. So it's a point of an all-out struggle for every section of the population. And since 1991, at least my organization vindicated that this is going to happen. Every aspect of that forecast today is a reality throughout the country. Even after Modi's coming into power and his advance statement, very arrogant statement that everything will be done, everything will be privatized, etc., etc. Even then, last 15 months or 16 months, every month our manufacturing production is dipping. Every month it is dipping. Every month plus 15 months process, the real income is taking a dip. Every day market is getting shrunk. Every day. And yet, we are hearing today economic survey has been published, there is a forecast of 7 to 7.5% growth in 2016-17. That is the forecast in the economic survey. 10 painting a very glorified picture, very glossy picture. But people forgot to ask what you have focused in previous year's economic survey. Whether that came true, they will forget to ask. We have to make people ask those questions. This is the responsibility of countries, advanced, most organized section of the society, that is workers. I consider you also workers, the workers' movement. They have to make people ask, raise them to a different level of consciousness. It is very crucial task me that we are fighting for saving public sector, not for saving our jobs, but for saving the country. Those who are working against counterpart public sector, they are enemies of the people. They are anti-national. It is they who are anti-national. This is what it's that with that conviction we have to address the issue. And then only we can carry the present stage of struggle to a further height towards our task of resisting this game. Public since 1991 that effort was on. We tried to develop a broader platform, and you will find at different names it came into being. Sponsoring committee of trade union, national campaign committee, these or that. Every time we try to broaden our platform to fight against these policies. And that led to a continuous effort, led to 12 general strike in the country. From 1991 itself, there was a common point in that.
Hello. আচ্ছা ঠিক আছে পরে কথা হচ্ছে
এ কমন পয়েন্ট ওয়াজ দেয়ার এগেন্স্ট প্রাইভেটাইজেশন এগেন্ট ডিস ইনভেস্টমেন্ট এ কমন পয়েন্ট ফ্রম ডে ওয়ান ফার্স্ট স্ট্রাইক ওয়াজ ইন 29 November 1991 দ্য কমন পয়েন্ট ওয়াজ প্রাইভেটাইজেশন এগেন্ট ডিস ইনভেস্টমেন্ট এভরি চার্টার অফ ডিম্যান্ড সিন্স দেন ইন ডিফারেন্ট manner, time, during this period, if you study, that their strategy of the government also changed. Initially, they are on disinvestment. Initially, they experimented disinvestment of the fast-moving shares and slow-moving shares, making a package on disinvestment. Many such things were experimented since 1991. And by the end of that decade, they first shifted towards privatization to strategic sale. It is not piecemeal sale of shares, but handover the ownership. Strategic sale means handing over 51% at least along with the controlling stake. It is during the last NDA regime under Atal Bihari Vajpayee, 10 public sector companies were sold out virtually on the basis of a single bidding. The concerned CAG report has exposed that thing. We also raised that in the parliament. There is no taker. And it is through that process present day Mukesh Ambani came into being. Indian Petrochemicals Limited was handed over despite Defence Ministry's objection. And that became his launching pad to become a giant in that sector. And the whole team of public sector trained officials played an important role to make that a giant, oil giant, both in the upstream and the downstream. You must go into that aspect. And now we are in a stage of a strategic sale. In between, there was a period where we could make the government retreat, just for whichever government, retreat on this ground, and nobody talked about strategic sale. Again, that strategic sale came back to the vocabularies of our ministers. And presently we are in that stage, they are perceiving strategic sell in all the oil companies. They are perceiving strategic sell in the banking sector as well. Finance Minister came on public comment. They are considering strategic sell also in the banking sector. That is, you lift it and sell it, majority stake. And the logic behind that, which they are, by media they are propagating, well, that will be, government will also play a role, but for a better management and better resource generation, we are handing it over, the controlling, managerial control. So that's why strategic sale is needed. That's the scale we are in now, in our safe public sector movement, that has also to be understood. Very few days back, I had an occasion to interact with the finance minister. I told that I will be coming someday along with a delegation from the bank employees. Some sort of inquisition was there to me from the bank employee movement. So while talking on that issue, he told me, okay, anytime you may come, but by you, something has to be done. Banks are in very dire straits. The NPAs have become unmanageable. And you have to have less communism on that. Please help me out. Is that standing in the way of your NPA? How those NPAs are generated? Who are the NPA creators? He told me personally, but I'm telling you, some 25 to 30 entities. They are the NPA generator, major NPA generator. 25 to 30 entities. I'm saying, this is your creation. Definitely there are no small and medium scale industries among them, below, no. Because they are always a faithful, they are never defaulters normally. And we are all big guys who are having breakfast, dinner with Prime Minister, who are travelling with your Prime Minister in their foreign trip. It is they who are the NPA holders. What are you going to do? For that, what will you do? Well, no, some managerial change is required. Same idea of strategic sell, he tried to hint upon. I told that you come out with your idea, we will respond, no problem. They're hinting, now they're making this a ground. So irresponsible. You have given credit without due diligence to all those biggies. So there must be a change of the game. And since in public sector there are certain rules and regulations of appointing both workers, officers, they are promoting, putting on a particular position, giving in the directorial position, all these things, there are some system is following, they want to get rid of that system. And in order to get rid of that system, and in the name of rewarding the performer, they want to bring out the entire change in the human resource management system of the branch, and they are trying to find that a plea for a strategic sale. Otherwise, CAG and other agencies' supervision from this sector has to be taken out. Why? There is NPA. Very shivering word they will be saying. The country's economy, financial economy will collapse. You have to see it that. Please accept, make some adjustment. This is going to be the philosophy in the days to come. And we have to combat this by carrying on our struggle. Unless we believe in ourselves and confident in that belief, that who are against the public sector, he is against the nation. Without that conviction, this satanic exercise cannot be fought back. It requires hatred in mind. Otherwise, resistance cannot be built up. Company went a long way. The 12th general strike since 1991 And in between numerous sectoral strike, of which banking employees played a very big role in those sectors, other sectors also, we could keep banks still in the present position. Some dilution in the stake, some here and there. That could not have been retained had there been no content struggle with a continuity. It could not be retained. And now this 12th strike, on the foundation of 12th general strike, a new change in the trade union movement has taken place, that those who are outside that struggle also have been compelled to come inside and join that struggle. All the central trade unions of all colors have to come together. In different sectoral exercises, when we used to talk about privatization, immediately there was a rebuff from the other side, some of the central trade unions. Now they came together after 2009 on a charter of demand, one of 5-point charter of demand. One of the points is against privatization and disinvestment. They have to accept that slogan. Earlier they used to oppose. So a new coalition developed in the trade union movement, where an all-in unity could be established. And under that, it was started with a one-day strike, followed by a two-day strike, and again on 2nd September there was another general strike. It was the 16th national strike we are heading with. Till now we are maintaining the still now balance. But we believe today the stage we have arrived at, it needs to be heightened further to the level of resistance. Because prior to 2014, nobody dared to talk about wholesale privatization of the banking sector. There are dozens of investment. There are many moves of indirect privatization. So many arrangements now started in the banking sector, I have seen. Your correspondence, etc., etc. Lot of jobs are being outsourced. These things are going on. But directly nobody could dare of privatizing the thing as a lot. But now it has become a commonplace. They are talking with loudly, arrogantly. And they will push through. And they have a number for that. And please understand, in Lok Sabha they have a number. And your financial sector related, most of the legislations are money bills. They will turn that at money bills. So once Lok Sabha cleared it, Rajya Sabha, even they have a different number here, they cannot do anything as per constitution of the country. What do you do now? As a trade union movement, you are facing a similar thing in the matter of labor law legislations, the overhauling that is going on. They want to create a condition of bonded labor on the workers. And as workers are made bonded as per law, you officers' community will face the worst situation. Must be very clear about that. So it is a part of your job as well to head-on confront the move of changing the labor laws altogether. The privatization of the entire governance through public sector privatization. The ultimate goal is to privatization of the governance under World Bank and IMF. International finance capital under a severe crisis cannot get a respite unless the governance of the developing countries are fully privatized and get into their pocket. Against this process, the resistant force are the workers. So they must be enslaved first. Their rights have to be taken away first. And once they are enslaved, whole nation can be slain, put under their command. The trade unions are always attack first. That is the history of the world, history of the trade union movement. An attack on trade union right is followed by the attack on the democratic structure itself. You cannot even conceive of, say, public sector movement without having a clear position in fighting that authoritarian design to enslave the entire citizenry of the country, which starts with enslaving the working people of the country by way of complete overhauling of the labor laws. No rights. Fully arbitrary. The whole exercise of the labor law changes are aimed at pushing out 90% of the workforce out of the protection of any labor law whatsoever. Lot of literatures are there, I need not go in explaining that, it is available. You can collect and get yourself educated. To combat in this particular position, I think the entire working people of the country must come together without any hesitation to strengthen the mainstream of struggle. There will be problems, there will be vacillations. No doubt of it. But if we have to oppose privatization, we have to overcome them. And if we have to place gradually ourselves in a position that in spite of executive decision, in spite of legislation decision, we will not allow this to be translated into action in my place, my workplace, if that kind of movement is to be developed, lot of risk are there, but we have to take that risk, otherwise we will not be able to save anything in the days to come. And we can confidently take that risk, provided all are together. We are trying our best to keep all together. It is not merely keeping leaders together, more important is to keeping those who are working in the workplace together. If that is ensured, leaders will be compelled to come together. I can tell you, we are seriously making effort in that direction. Till now, before 2nd September strike, BMS deserted us. They again came back. On 4th of January, when we met the finance minister in our pre-budget consultation, they have signed along with us the memorandum we have submitted to them, which basically demands that your present regime of disinvestment, privatization, outsourcing, casualization, contractualization, etc. must be completely reversed if country's economic growth rate has to be improved in real terms. There is no shortcut in that. We told on his face, finance minister's face. We told that unless you take a seriously protective measure for country's industry, you will not be able to save the country's industry as well. They came together. We are making some exercises. Coming 10th March, we have decided for a national protest day based on our 12-point demands. Two major points is against contractualization, outsourcing, and another against privatization, disinvestment, and now we have added strategic cell this time. And by the end of this month, possibly on 30th March, a national convention will be there, and therefrom we will be declaring our next course of action. And that action program will be designed to gradually elevate us to the stage of resistance, because by this time many executive or legislative order will come into being. Budget session has started now. In this part of the session nothing much will happen, but next part is a very crucial part. It will be starting from 23rd April. Very crucial part. That understanding need to be built up. And here, I know there are various limitations, resolutions, etc., etc. I can only tell you, present situation cannot afford that kind of a thing. Cannot afford that kind of a thing. Please consider. Please consider. The mainstream struggle, unless your strength is not added to that, our seriousness on the whole issue would be inevitably questioned. Please consider. That's the time now. They will try to disintegrate. And that's why this new theory of who is national, who is anti-national has started. It's a parallel game, but project of the same, part of the same project. They will mortgage our nation. They will break the spine of our national economy, the public sector. And at the same time, people unitedly cannot resist that. They are trying to ensure that thing by completely disrupting the people's unity. It is a part of the same project. It is not a job of a bad man or a good man or an insensitive man. No. It is coming from the same source, part of the same project. The issue on which I have been busy in Parliament today, for years, for that I get, it is that issue. It has to be done, understood. Whichever political ideology you do believe. But we definitely believe, at least that consensus here, that public sector cannot be played upon, allowed to be played upon by the government, whichever government is there. That cannot be allowed to be played upon. That has to be told. I think there is no difference in the understanding that who are speaking against public sector, who are working against the public sector, they are enemy of the nation. I don't think there is any difference in that consensus. Then every struggle against weakening the public sector, every struggle against privatization, every struggle of indirectly infiltrating private controller on the management of public sector through rampant outsourcing, contractualization, etc. The whole package of our demand, we have to look at it as a package. Unless that mainstream struggle is not strengthened with broader and broader mobilization, we will not be able to elevate ourselves to the stage of resistance which is going to be the urgent need of the hour in the days to come. If we can't fail in doing that, come to the whole, whatever achievement post-independence we could get, we have to go back to 20 years. It will be a backward retreat. It will be a menace. It will be a disaster for our society. It will be a disaster for the progressive society which you want to build. It will have a serious bearing on the future of our future generation, our children, for which we are working, for whom we are working. These are all closely interrelated and correlated. So you have to make your contribution, can make a contribution, crucial contribution, to the whole intellectual capability of the country's trade union movement by your inputs. But at the same time, the all-out effort of unifying the entire resistance, a strong opposition against what is going on now, on that there cannot be any room for vacillation. You have to seriously consider that aspect also. In the days to come, further plan is going on. Meantime, at a sectoral level, you have to also plan your resistance. Every sector-specific areas, you have certain special issues relating to this policy, that issue also need to be addressed. Right now, before I spoke, I was hearing from our counter from Naberts, he told about the achievements and its capacity to do. With that achievement and capacity, we have to seriously inquire and make it public. Why, and why? The two-thirds of our presence are out of the institutional credit. It is those segments of creditors who will provide the loan, they are not defaulters. A small creditor, the muscle men are sent to his house to realize the loan. But the big creditors like Vijay Malaya, hopping from one country to another, still carrying on very merrily. He is also a member of the parliament also in my house. Why so? Kya aapka nana lagta hai? Will you not ask? The banks who are not, whom he is not paying back, will you not go and ask your executive director, kya aapka nana lagta hai? Uske chhod kyun rakha hai? Why should not there be criminal case against him? It is not addressing to that particular officer. I am telling you, you ask the same question to your minister. Why so? And on the ground of the same MPA, you will try to dismantle whatever system that could be developed by the nationalized banking system, nationalized insurance system of the country, on the name of addressing that MPA. ये बात तो बोलना जरूरी है. I told Arun Jaitley that day when he was telling 22, 25, 22, why don't you publish their name? No, there is a problem in that. I think you can bring out those names. You can if you try. Make it public. I think at one point of time AIBA did that job and it really created a very big boost. Can do that job successfully, and that will be an important contribution, very important contribution in strengthening the civil, in exposing their game plan and also strengthening the safe public sector movement. Very important contribution. How can you do that? You can do it. It will be a big help to the overall trade union movement also. That cannot be, that can be brought to surface. Who are those criminals? Two types. One is it is a game there. Get credit, move into default, then renegotiate, reschedule the loan, then finally through asset reconstruction process, get a big portion of that loan not to be paid and baki they have settled. Every settlement leads to writing off of a big amount. Public money. They don't have a right to do so, but they do it. And another segment of NPA, there is a genuine NPA as well. A major part of their NPA are from power sector. And as of date, at least 11 power plants, they are commissioned, but not generating power. The whole money is locked. Because they could not yet start earning revenue. Why? Is there a power surplus country? Till now 40% of our country is not electrified. Till now. Around 40%. Government is claiming 28%. To my assessment it is 40%. They are not electrified. Still 11 power plant is not producing power because price is not matching them. All private sector power plant. Public sector power plant, despite getting an unremunerative price, they are producing power, supplying to nation. But their case also, in their case also, there is underutilization of capacity. You are talking of a country having a 7 to 7.5% GDP growth and out of 2058 lakh megawatt capacity, you are now producing 2 lakh, little less than 30,000 megawatt capacity. We require power. We have power generating capacity. We are not producing food. Why there is no taker of power? So we require power, at the same time there is no taker of power. This paradox the country is put in by this. And this is the lifeline of the crisis the whole capitalist system is now engulfed with. The whole pricing mechanism, channelizing the distribution to the private discoms has gone to such an extent. Government has given all infrastructure. We have a national grid, Power Grid Corporation of India did a tremendous job linking the entire country with the power grid, distribution grid. But even then, this has become open. And this is also a source of a major part of your NPA. It is not only your bank, commercial bank, even, I have been told, even HDFC. HDFC, HUDCO, which is basically housing development. They have also given loan to power sector. In a meeting of Committee of Public Undertaking, of which I am a member, I asked them, what makes you give money for the power sector? It is not your mandate. You are for urban development. And don't stretch your imagination to tell that urban development means electricity generation. Don't stretch. For that a different designated defined department is there. What makes you to give? And definitely you have given to some private sector companies. But yes, sir. It's political pressure. And finally that became an NPA for them. So, and again this NPA is being made a plea for changing your established system. Targeted at changing the ownership. These investments, some doors to be followed by strategic sale. This is the game plan time to come. I think in advance you must bring this with a very arrogant and militant demonstrative exercise. Bring this to public domain that will not allow you to do so, even if you try to do so. I think sectorally that kind of a heat need to be generated. And I think the bank movement, as the idea of having, I see the number of programs are there in the coming week, first week of March onwards, different bank unions individually and thereafter together. I think this must be on a continuity, it should be focused with all arrogance and militancy that will not allow you to do so. So, comrade, I think I should not elongate my speech any further. As I want you to understand three aspects. First, that your privatization of banks is a part of the whole privatization exercise of the entire public sector network. Nothing special for bank, nothing special for LIC. The present policy regime led by the International Finance Capital, the whole philosophy is that the state must withdraw itself from this kind of business activities. There is no business for the state to remain in business, but definitely there is a business for the state to support the business houses and communities, corporate communities, not the people. This is their policy. So, the whole privatization is a part of this thing. And the present policy regime is also designed to make the economies of this developing country a satellite of the metropolitan capital. This is their second strategy. And for that, the post-Second World War, the economy of the developing countries, not only ours, in most of the other developing countries, we developed on a public sector driving engine. Those need to be dismantled. In many of the developing countries, those already have been dismantled. We did not allow it to do so till now. In a big way, some dilution has taken place. So it is a part of that policy package. This is number one. And this is become a compulsion for them in view of the much deepening and aggravating crises of the entire capitalist order. Without doing this, they cannot transfer the burden of the crisis to the people. Much more transfer is required. For that, austerity measures are coming in Europe. people are fighting against that also. So to facilitate this austerity process, privatization is a must. When the whole European Union is negotiating with the new government of Greece, these are the conditions that you must privatize your public sectors, institutions. The fight is still going on there. So this is a part of the whole package. And this whole package is coming out of politics. By politics, I don't say the politics of a particular party. The basic politics, whose basic philosophy is that state no more remain in these economic activities as the engine of the economic activities. In a developing country, saying this is committing economic suicide. We are not allowed so long defending our public sector and retaining 90% of the public sector in its own position by your struggle with continuity. So long we have been successfully till now retaining that position, and we stop the country from committing such suicides. Now it is desperate because crisis is more severe. Unless you link, that's the politics. Whosoever pursues this politics, they are enemies of the people, enemies of the workers, enemies of yours, enemies of ours. From whichever politics it may come, whichever political party it may come, unhesitatingly we have to retune our consciousness in that direction. Ultimately, all these decisions are basically political decisions. None of them are economic decisions. These are basically political decisions. Unless we realize the basic politics of that, the mortgaging of the country, privatization is an integral part of that. Surrendering our country's interest in the interest of international finance capital, privatization is a part of that. And another part of that is to disunite the people through divisive line, part of the same project. Only unifying the entire class, we can combat both the danger. And in that direction, I can only urge upon you, as your fellow traveler, we could do something till now, keeping the flock together in the country's trade union movement. You have been with us all along in most of the struggles, barring some few. I intentionally put this because at times that problem comes and that is not a welcome situation. In today's situation, that will be much more costlier in the days to come. Please think about. And the mainstream struggle has to be strengthened by broader mobilization on the one hand, and your sectoral struggle has to be strengthened, expanded beyond your own workplace to carry the message to the people that you are fighting against privatization not for your job but for the country. And those who are trying to privatize, they are enemies of the people, enemies of the nation, they are the real anti-national. This message needs to be carried to the people. You people are intellectually sound, you can develop some documentation, you develop some messages, and you can carry that messages to the masses of the people. Nowadays, technology will also help you in a very big way. Our mainstream struggle, we don't have time to do that job. We need your help, need your support. So in that direction, an all-round effort is required, and I believe the path we are now traversing, unifying the entire force, if we can carry on, howsoever arrogant one may be, howsoever bulldozing approach one may take, they will not finally succeed. Question comes that their point of failure come when? Sometimes after legislation, in the resistance of translating that legislation into action, translating such executive orders in action at the place, In that stage, we must prepare ourselves. Time is for the such stage of struggle. Let us all try, and I believe your help, your intellectual support, your factual support, and your own sectoral struggle, all together will strengthen the cause of the fight against privatization, saving public sector, and thereby saving the nation, and also defeating the most anti-national the force now at the helm of governments of the country. Thank you, Comrade.